Have you ever tried to look at milk under an optical microscope and didn't see anything interesting? That is because a more powerful electron microscope is needed. Canadian scientist Miloš Kalab has had that luck, and he is now inviting you to follow the transitions of liquid milk into solid milk products. He may have some surprises for you. Here is the first surprise. Tiny globules of milk protein called casein micelles move in liquid milk in all directions, collide with each other, occasionally also hit much larger fat globules, much larger than the one shown in red color. When acids or enzymes make the micelles sticky, the motion stops. The micelles coagulate and the milk curdles. Then the micelles, shown at right, may be photographed as they coagulate into chains to form yogurt or into clusters to be made into cheese. Curdling is also one of the first steps in digesting milk when we drink it. A Philips environmental scanning electron microscope was used to obtain most images for this presentation. There may be another surprise. The samples had first been coated with a very thin layer of gold before they were photographed. In the right upper corner, there is a yogurt with bacteria, small round streptococci and long lactobacilli. At the bottom and left, there are lactic acid bacteria in a goat cheese, and a processed cheese sample melted on a pizza is at right. In a transmission electron microscope such as this Hitachi, the image is formed as a shadow of the sample placed into the path of a beam of highly accelerated electrons. A column of three images shows casein micelles, either in a single layer shadowed with platinum vapor, top, or below as a section of a pellet obtained by ultracentrifugation of fixed casein micelles, or at the bottom as a section of a coagulum consisting of casein micelles in the presence of whey proteins. The next column shows thin sections. American white cheese made with an acid instead of bacteria is at the top with casein shown in dark color and fat globules shown in yellow. Below are two fat globules with a detail of crystallized fatty acids in light color. The peculiar ovals with dark bars inside are starch granules in a meat binder, a mixture of milk solids, spices and starch. Casein micelles appear as the tiny dots in the sample. My recent collaborators shown here in front of me are the authors of many micrographs published jointly, including those in this slide. Keith Hubbard, in the back, photographed a corn seed by confocal laser scanning microscopy, and Fu Jiang, in front of him, is the author of an SEM image of fructose crystals on a dried fig, and Denis Chabot took the SEM image of starch granules in potato cells. There is a wide variety of interesting images of dairy products depending on the manufacturing processes and other conditions. Let's have a look at the differences between cheddar cheese at left and a string cheese at right. All cheeses may be processed when so-called melting salts are added to them and the mixture is heated and stirred. Bacteria are important in the dairy industry. In addition to lactic acid bacteria, some other bacteria such as bifidobacteria are highly prized, whereas Campylobacter jejuni bacteria at left are known to cause severe food poisoning and must be avoided. Microorganisms in kefir, which are concentrated in the kefir grains consisting of the kefiran gel, are important representatives of dairy probiotics. Specific lactic acid bacteria provide characteristic flavor to some cheeses, such as the Gouda cheese shown in the right upper corner. Liquid milk products may be spray dried for future use. It may be another surprise that their globular particles are full of air in the form of vacuoles, be it spray dried buttermilk or spray dried skim milk. Based on my early scientific achievements, The American Dairy Science Association awarded me with the Pfizer 1982 Award in Cheese and Cultured Products Research. Thus encouraged, I continued with my dairy research until my retirement in 1994. Then, as an honorary research associate, I have included additional foods in my studies. In 2018, the Food Structure and Functionality Forum and the International Dairy Federation honored me in Montreal with the Dr. Isaac Hirtje Distinguished Scientist Award. The award ceremony took place at the Joint Congress of the Food Structure and Functionality Forum and the International Dairy Federation in Montreal in June 2018. I was unable to attend for health reasons, but Dr. Derek Rousseau, Editor-in-Chief of Food Structure, presented the award several days earlier to me in Ottawa. At the Congress, he projected my PowerPoint presentation, where I have summarized some of my scientific achievements, and I also thanked for the award. That presentation now follows. Ladies and gentlemen, I am greatly honored by the Food Structure and Functionality Forum and the International Dairy Federation that have conferred the Isaac Hirtje Lifetime Achievement Award on me, and I thank for the honor. It is a pleasure for me to present a brief overview of some of my contributions to food structure studies during my career at Agriculture Canada in Ottawa until my retirement in 1994, since when I have been still working as an honorary research associate.
Miroslav, here is a new job for you. Take milk and make hot dogs from it. Use only heat-induced gelation and have the hot dogs ready for sale over all Canada in 1974.
Thus spoke the director, and that was my first assignment in my new position in Ottawa in 1969. Irrespective of how I heated the skim milk, the hot dogs remained an elusive goal. My heat-induced milk gels were worse than bad cheese, really bad. Then I looked at it under an electron microscope and I recognized why it was so. My gels consisted of balls, casein micelles, shown in the slide at left, but hot dogs, shown in the slide at right, consist of muscle fibers. Plain heating is no magic. It cannot give elasticity and juiciness to curdled milk, and it cannot give it the structure of meat-based hot dogs. Before my director could give me a bad performance appraisal for my failure, a new director, Dr. John Holm, took over the institute. He cancelled the illusory hot dog project. Instead, he approved my intention to study the structure of foods using electron microscopy. He was also very supportive of my activity as the editor-in-chief of Food Structure. He was my best director during my long career. He really appreciated my work and was interested in my findings, and he gave me complete scientific freedom to study foods of agricultural origin. To work with him was a pleasure. Casein micelles in milk are in constant motion until the integrity of their surfaces is affected by proteolytic enzymes or by acids. Then they coagulate either into clusters, as shown in the slide at left, to produce cheese, or they form short branched chains, as shown in the slide at right, to produce yogurt. The difference depends on the heating of milk. Casein micelles in unheated milk, shown in the slide at left, may interact during coagulation indiscriminately with each other. In milk heated higher than 85 degrees Celsius for 10 minutes or more, a whey protein called beta-lactoglobulin reacts with kappa casein of the micelles and forms blocks on their surfaces, which severely limit the extent of the coagulation. The micelles thus form branched chains, as shown in the slide at right. This fact helped us to solve a grittiness problem in a newly developed cheese spread. its developers were unable to make it smooth by any measure applied. Electron microscopy has found that the tiny hard particles causing the grittiness were compact like cheese, as shown in this slide. In contrast, the rest of the spread resembled yogurt. We asked the developers whether the milk had been heated before coagulation. Yes, it was, to 90 degrees, and then it was cooled immediately to 40 degrees. My advice: to hold the heating at 90 degrees for at least 10 minutes completely eliminated the grittiness, and the spread was nicely smooth. Cultured milk products contain lactic acid bacteria. In the micrographs, they are often found surrounded by void spaces. Why is that? Bacterial capsules, which consist of soluble polysaccharides, prevent the casein micelles from getting very close to the bacteria. When the sample is fixed and the capsules are washed out, the space around the bacteria becomes void, as seen in this slide. Would you believe it that the ropy lactobacilli in this slide have attached themselves intentionally to the curd in order not to be removed along with the whey? Some dairy workers used to believe it, but the truth is different. The filaments originated from very thick bacterial capsules which had not been washed out during the preparation of the sample for electron microscopy, and they shrank into filaments during the dehydration. The filaments are thus an artifact. Milk fat is an important component of many milk products, but it cannot be properly shown in samples fixed by osmium tetroxide unless imidazole is also present to protect the fat while the sample is processed for microscopy. The large micrograph shows fat globules dispersed in a fresh coagulum consisting of casein micelles. The small transmission electron micrograph in the right upper corner shows a thin section of two fat globules which contain saturated fat crystals inside. Many cheeses, examined by scanning electron microscopy, show thin, linear areas depleted of fat globules. They develop when freshly coagulated milk is cut by wire knives into small cubes and fat globules are released from the cut surfaces into the whey. On pressing, the curd granules join each other with their fat-depleted surfaces. To a naked eye, the patterns appear as dark lines on the cheese slices. They are simple in stirred curd cheeses, as shown in the slide at left, and they are complex in cheddar cheese, shown in the slide at right. The patterns reflect manual, mechanized or automated cheddaring procedures. In the 80s, when the provincial cheese specialist in Alberta, Dr. Bob Lowry, demonstrated to cheddar cheese manufacturers how easily an omission of cheddaring is detected. This finding has contributed to ensuring that all cheddar cheese is manufactured correctly and consumer rights are protected. Here, the microstructure of the junctions is shown by electron microscopy as compact protein areas in contrast to the interior parts of the granules where many fat globules are dispersed. Extraction of the fat with chloroform or N-hexane makes the surface to scatter light and to appear lighter than the compact junctions. The junction at left is marked with white arrows. It is over 20 micrometers wide, similar to the junction in another kind of cheese shown at right. The development of the junctions may be seen in the diagram at left, along with a link to more details. Meat binders are used to hold the ingredients of salami together. They may legally contain milk solids, except buttermilk, which would impart rancid off flavor during storage. It has been banned by the government, but it cannot be distinguished by chemical analysis in the presence of other milk solids. A company sent us a sample from their competitors, which allegedly contained the illegal ingredient. Could we detect it? We based our analysis on the differences between the structural components of milk solids, that is, casein micelles, shown in the slide at left, and the characteristic components of buttermilk shown in the slide at right, that is, fat globule membrane fragments which originate from the churning of cream. Whom did the company suspect? Nobody. They themselves wanted to cheat, and they were curious to know whether the government can enforce its regulations. In commercial processed cheese, shown in the slide at left, electron microscopy revealed unusual minute dense particles seen at a higher magnification in the slide at right. What are they? Cheese already once processed, which solidified in the pipes by accident. It was retrieved, pulverized, and added a so-called rework to a batch of a fresh cheese blend. The processed cheese manufacturer was stunned by the abilities of electron microscopy when I gave him the images. The surfaces of primary spray dried milk particles show bumps or dents. American colleague Dr. Norm Singer helped us to explain how these features develop during spray drying. Small milk droplets dry and harden more quickly than large droplets. If the large droplets are still wet and soft, the colliding small hard particles are captured and embedded in the surfaces. If, however, the large particles are already somewhat solidified but still not hard, the colliding small hard particles leave dents in their surfaces and ricochet away. The diagram at the top explains the process. To make spray-dried milk easily soluble, the primary individual powder particles are agglomerated by rewetting with water or steam. During my career, I collaborated with many researchers all over the world on a wide variety of projects. I wish to thank them all and acknowledge their contributions to my studies, particularly the late Dr. Doug Emmons, a globally renowned dairy scientist. He advised his director to hire me when I desperately looked for work in 1968, although he knew that I had no knowledge of dairy science. He probably sensed that I can adapt and learn, and he was right. My close colleague, friend and co-author was the late Dr. Harry Harvalkar. He is shown here pumping a cow's tail, apparently to collect fresh milk with his technician Terry for new experiments. Harry was a theorist who studied the coagulation of milk, and I examined his samples by electron microscopy. Then we found an unusual ultrastructure of casein micelles. We called it the core and shell ultrastructure. It develops in heated milk, acidified to pH 5.5. It is characteristic of Indian paneer and American white cheeses. The structure is so resilient that it resists cheese processing and may be found in processed cheese if it had been present among its ingredients. In 1979, three American scientists invited me to Chicago to present my studies at the annual conference of scanning electron microscopy organized by the late Dr. Om Johari, shown in this slide. 3 years later, this group started to publish a new food microstructure journal. The editors elected me to act as the editor-in-chief. Dr. Isaac Hirtje from the Netherlands, whose name the Lifetime Achievement Award is bearing, joined the Food Microstructure Journal as its European editor in 1989. He suggested to change the title of the journal to Food Structure. The change was very beneficial, and the frequency of publication has increased to 4 issues per annum. Dr. Isaac Hirtje, whose name the award is bearing, has been a world-known food research scientist based in the Netherlands. His special interests were milk products and fats and oils. His articles on fat spreads and eggs are still being hosted on my website as shown here. In the 70s, research papers were written with a pencil on lined paper and then copied by typists. Electron micrographs were taken on sensitive black and white film or plates, developed in a dark room and enlarged to obtain micrographs. There were no computers, no internet and no email. Eventually, however, computers have arrived and I was the first researcher in the building to own my portable Osborne 1 computer with a 3x3 inches monitor and bring it regularly to the laboratory. I have learned the HTML codes before there were any editors, and I established my first website, which I still operate. Eager to spread information about the structure of foods, I offered my micrographs to a local television station in Ottawa. When the director of programming asked what the picture showed, and I said, lactic acid bacteria in yogurt, she advised me to get out of her office immediately. She did not want, as she said, that the station would be sued by yogurt manufacturers if it showed that their product contained bacteria. In 1993, the late Dr. Johari stopped publishing Food Structure abruptly without any explanation. This was a great setback to many food microscopists on the global scale. It lasted until 2015, when Elsevier publishers started publishing a new journal under the same title. Before Dr. Johari passed away in 2015, he expressed his desire that everything he had published be available to anybody at no charge. Dr. Dan McMahon in Utah undertook the Herculean task and has digitized and archived all food structure issues. This slide shows how to access the papers. The papers are stored in Utah in PDF format. They may be downloaded at no charge and no registration required. Each paper has a counter shown in this slide at right, which indicates how many times it had been downloaded. As an example, a joint paper on dried milk products with Dr. Mariana Caric has been downloaded over 3,000 times since 2015, and on the whole, scientific papers from the journal have been downloaded between 2016 and the early 2019 148,000 times. Several years ago, I have joined the professional network for scientists and researchers called ResearchGate, which was established in 2008. Members share and exchange ideas, access other members' publications, and obtain various services. This image shows that almost 11,000 colleagues read my papers up to March 2018, and another 6,000 read them in the next year. ResearchGate also records citations in scientific literature. This was a very short overview of my work. My first hopeless project on milk-based hot dogs in my new position in Canada could have ruined my career. Instead, thanks to several lucky coincidences, it had directed me towards rewarding scientific studies of food structure. The processes which take place in foods on microscopical and submicroscopical scales in dairies, breweries, bakeries, and in kitchens around the world are as impressive as the processes taking place on the macro scale in the depth of our Earth or in distant galaxies, but have yet to be similarly popularized. I hope that you enjoyed the images of milk. In conclusion, I thank once more the Food Structure and Functionality Forum and the International Dairy Federation for the Isaac Hirtia Lifetime Achievement Award and to the audience for your attention. Thank you all.